The next item of business is consideration of business motion 9246 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on a change to today's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and moved.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 9246 be agreed. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed. And before we move to the next item of business, I invite members to join me in welcoming to the gallery the Honourable Mark Monaghan, MLA, Speaker of the Legislative Assembly of the Northern Territory. The next item of business is topical questions, and at question number one, I call Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether orthopaedic appointments and surgeries, when they do not require the use of general anaesthetic, should be carried out in community hospitals.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Presiding Officer, health boards will always try and offer patients appointments in their local area. However, patients may be offered an appointment at a different location, such as a national treatment centre, to ensure that they are seen as quickly as possible. Treatment decisions are made by clinicians, taking into account the patient's treatment needs and ability to travel. Estate availability and staffing are key considerations for health boards to maximise the number of patients seen. Boards may try to protect theatres for arthroplasty procedures requiring anaesthetic or spinal blocks and undertake local anaesthetic cases in community hospitals, treatment rooms and day theatres.
Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The National Treatment Centre is a great addition to the Highlands and we all appreciate it up there. However, patients in Caithness welcomed orthopaedic surgeons travelling to Caithness General, for example, to carry out lists and minor surgeries and to review cases, which meant that they didn't have to travel all the way to Raigmore, which could take 2 hours. An orthopaedic surgeon could carry out a series of, say, 40 case reviews on his list over a period of 2 days. Surely that's good use of their time and national health resources.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I recognise the concerns which Mr Mountain has raised, and as he also acknowledges, the National Treatment Centre in the Highlands at Raigmore will offer significant additional capacity for elective procedures in the Highland area. I also recognise the need to try to minimise the need for patients to travel excessive distances within the Highlands in particular, where they have longer enduring painful conditions or whether they are going through ongoing treatment as well. I would certainly want to encourage NHS Highland to look at how they can minimise the need for patients to travel to Raigmore where possible, and if there is scope for further procedures to be undertaken at Caithness General Hospital, including review visits where possible. But I'm also conscious that not all of this work requires orthopaedic surgeons. Some of this can be carried out by MSK physiotherapists, by advanced nurse practitioners that specialise in orthopaedics, all of which could contribute to helping to reduce the need for patients to travel to centres such as Raigmore.
Edward Mountain.
And I welcome that answer from the Cabinet Secretary. But my issue is, in relation to patients in remote rural areas, is that being able to see an orthopaedic surgeon is extremely useful, especially when their case is being reviewed, say, after an operation. So my constituents are concerned that, having heard that NHS Highland will have to reduce its budget by 60 million, that this is one of the outcomes of it. And can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to urge NHS Highland to speak more fully with the orthopaedic department to make sure that they are taken along with NHS Highland's plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, Presiding Officer, I would expect the Health Board to look at how they can maximise the benefits that they get from the existing clinical group they have within their orthopaedic department at the present moment, and how they can utilise their skills to the best of their ability in order to meet the needs of those who require orthopaedic procedures within NHS Island area. Whether that be treatment that's been carried out at the National Treatment Centre at Raigmore, or whether it be procedures that can be carried out in district general hospitals. I would certainly want to encourage them to do so, and I'll certainly make sure that I raise this issue with the board in order to encourage them to look at what further action they can take in order to address the concerns that have been raised by Mr Mountain.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank my colleague member from Dumbarton, who tabled the parliamentary question that uncovered the extent of orthopaedic waiting times in Scotland, as reported in the press over the weekend. The government is quick to point to the National Treatment Centre that opened in Fife back in May, but people are still languishing on orthopaedic waiting lists. So does the Cabinet Secretary accept that his predecessor failed to deliver an end to the two-year orthopaedic surgery waiting times? And can he confirm how many orthopaedic surgeries have been carried out this year so far, and whether the new National Treatment Centre will meet its target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Opposite officer, I'm sure everyone in the chamber, including Mr Sweeney, recognises that we have gone through a pandemic which has had a significant impact on capacity within our NHS, which has resulted in many elective procedures having to be cancelled or reduced significantly, which has resulted in a significant backlog. And the NHS in Scotland is facing the same challenges as is faced across the rest of the UK and globally to some extent healthcare systems, where we're having to work our way through those significant backlogs. We have made steady progress in reducing those backlogs, particularly those who have had the longest waits. We are seeing capacity increasing across our territorial health boards. We're adding to that capacity through the creation of the National Treatment Centres, which have already started to open, which are providing additional capability and capacity, and that will help us in helping to reduce the overall waits that people have to wait. I don't want anyone to wait for a procedure longer than they have to, but what we also have to acknowledge is a very significant disruption has been to the NHS over the course of the last 2 years, and it will take some time in order to reduce those backlogs, but we are doing everything we can to increase capacity and to reduce those waits as much as we can.
Question number two, Monica Lennon.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what advice and support it can provide to parents and carers who are struggling to afford nappies and infant feed in light of recent reports regarding nappy needs, difficulties in accessing baby formula at food banks, and families with young children being forced to cut back on essentials.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Tackling poverty and protecting people from harm is one of the Scottish Government's three critical missions, and the Scottish Government is working closely with national and local partners to understand the scale and nature of infant and maternal food insecurity to support longer-term responses. It's crucial to make sure people get the right help where and when they need it, and I would encourage anyone in need to get advice from a range of services or to speak to their midwives, health visitors or family nurses, who can provide appropriate guidance on any money worries and help families with infants to get prompt access to appropriate nutritional support during this cost of living crisis. I would always encourage everyone eligible, of course, to apply for the Scottish Government benefits they may be entitled to, including Best Start Foods, Best Start Grants and, of course, the Scottish Child Payment. The Scottish Government recognises the pressure on household budgets, which is why both last year and this, we have allocated almost £3 billion to support policies which tackle poverty and protect people as far as possible during the ongoing cost of living crisis.
Monica Lennon.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response, and I know she shares my concerns about some of the heartbreaking findings that were in the Sunday Post at the weekend in their special investigation, and including the findings of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation survey. There was a lot in that investigation, but I want to pick up on this issue of baby formula and the perceived rules around the UNICEF guidelines. We've got mums being turned away from food banks. It's not the fault of the food bank volunteers and charities, but mums have been left in tears because of the interpretation of these guidelines. Paediatrician Dr Ruth Bland has warned that the effect of watering down formula to make it last longer will very quickly have a negative impact on babies' health. And we know that children are going without the nutrition that they need. So what work can government do to work with a range of partners, including food bank charities, to make sure that those who are asking for baby formula can access it when they need it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Monica Lennon for raising this very important issue, and also pay tribute to the Sunday Post for the very concerning aspects that they highlighted at the weekend. The UNICEF guidance does recognise that in certain circumstances where there is no immediate alternative, food banks can make use of crisis funding to support families to purchase the right supply. The main point that UNICEF make, and we agree with them on this, is that food banks and anyone else supporting a family in desperate need should refer them to a local authority or a health professional who can ensure that they are getting holistic support, including financial advice. I would absolutely also highlight the work that has been done, for example, on the Parent Club website to provide parents with information on how to safely make up baby formula. Monica Lennon is again quite right to point to the dangers of watering down formula. And the information on the Parent Club website does set out all first formula is required to meet the same nutritional standard, and also makes the point that price does not equate to a better product. So that again, we encourage everyone to seek advice from a health visitor, a midwife, family nurse, to ensure that they're getting the widest support possible that they can during these very difficult times.
Monica Lennon.
Again, I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary, and also just to mention the campaign charity Feed UK, founded by Dr. Erin Williams, again, who's saying that many food banks don't supply baby formula because they wrongly believe it's illegal to do so, and that's not the case, so we need to get that message out. I want to turn to the issue of nappy needs. I was recently asked along to Nappy Runs, a small charity based in Edinburgh, and they supply thousands of nappies every week for families in need. When I was there, a health visitor had popped in to collect nappies for a young mum and her baby who are in poverty. Toy and Wear, who runs the charity, fears that mums and children are becoming socially isolated because they cannot afford all the changes that their baby needs, so they are rationing nappies. Words I never thought I would say in 2023. So I've asked the government before, but I'll ask again, what work is being done to address this issue of hidden nappy needs, and what support is available for charities like Nappy Runs and Nappy Libraries to provide support for families who need it?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, again, a very important point raised by Monica Lennon, and both myself and my fellow minister, Ms Minto, who's here with me today, would be happy to ensure that we are doing everything right across government that we can to work both with food banks, food bank networks and others, so that there is a shared understanding of the UNICEF guidance and what more we can do on that issue, and indeed ensure that we are doing everything that we can to look very carefully at the issue of nappies and nappy rationing. And I agree absolutely with Monica Lennon that it does beg our belief that we are talking about that today within Scotland. So there is, and as I said in my previous answers, a degree of support that can be given both within the health service but also within wider advice services around this issue. But I'm always happy to work with Ms Lennon, as I hope she knows, on this and other issues to see if there's more that can be done. And I include my fellow ministers in that as well.
Emma Harper.
There is no doubt that soaring prices of essential products are exacerbating the already challenging circumstances faced by parents, as Monica Lennon has just highlighted, particularly those people on low incomes. What additional action is the Scottish Government taking within its limited powers and budget to support people during this cost of living crisis? And what more does the Cabinet Secretary consider that the UK Government should be doing to help as well?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll point to one aspect, presiding officer, that the Scottish Government is doing, and that's, of course, our five family payments, which includes the Scottish Child Payment, Best Start Foods and the three Best Start payments, which could be worth up to £10,000 by the time an eligible child turns six. And, of course, I've recently announced that we will be changing the regulations to remove the income thresholds from Best Start Foods, so around 20,000 additional pregnant mums and children under three will be able to benefit from February 24. I would also highlight information, however, that's came out today that the Scottish Government in 23-24 made £83.7 million available to local authorities to spend on discretionary housing payments to mitigate the bedroom tax, to ensure that we are protecting families from the other damaging impacts of UK government welfare cuts, including the low rate of local housing allowance and the benefit cap. That is £83.7 million that we could be using on further anti-poverty measures if we were not mitigating against other aspects of the UK welfare system.